I'm telling
you,
there's gonna be another war. I mean, those slobs in the Pentagon are gonna be out of a job unless they find a new enemy. And they got this Saddam character now. I mean, they're gonna hit him with all they got. I mean, mark my words.
How's it going?
Hey, Auggie.
Two, right?
No, make it one.
You usually get two.
I know. I'm trying to cut down. Someone is worried about my health.
How's the work going these days, Maestro?
Fine. Or it was until a couple days ago. I got a call from a guy from the New York Times. They want me to write a Christmas story. They want to publish it on Christmas Day.
That's a feather in your cap, man. The paper of record.
Yeah, it's great, except I have to come up with something in 4 days, and I haven't got a single idea. You don't know any Christmas stories, do you?
Christmas stories? Sure. I know a ton of them.
You know any good ones?
Good ones? Of course. Are you kidding? I'll tell you what. Buy me lunch, my friend, and I'll tell you the best Christmas story you ever heard. How's that? And I guarantee every word of it is true.
So, we're ready?
Ready. Whenever you are.
I'm all ears.
Remember how you once asked me how I started taking pictures? Well, this is the story of how I got my first camera. As a matter of fact, it's the only camera I've ever had. Are you following me so far?
Every word.
So, this is the story of how it happened. Okay. It was the summer of 76, back when I first started working for Vinny. The summer of the bicentennial. The kid came in one morning and started stealing things from the store. He's standing by the rack of paperbacks along the far wall. He's stuffing skin magazines under his shirt. I didn't see him at first because it was crowded around the counter. But once I noticed what he was up to, I started to shout. He took off like a jackrabbit. And by the time I got out from behind the counter, he was already tearing ass down 7th Avenue. I chased him about half a block. Then I gave up. He dropped something along the way. And since I didn't feel like running anymore, I bent down to see what it was. It turned out to be his wallet. There wasn't any money inside, but his driver's license was there, along with 3 or 4 snapshots. I suppose I could have called the cops and had him arrested. I had his name and address from the license. But I felt kind of sorry for him. He was just a measly little punk. And once I looked at those pictures in his wallet, I couldn't bring myself to feel very angry at him. Roger Goodwin. That was his name. In one of the pictures, I remember he was standing next to his mother. In another one, he was holding a trophy he got at school and smiling like he just won the Irish sweepstakes. I just didn't have the heart. A poor kid from Brooklyn, without much going for him. He cared about a couple of dirty magazines anyway. So I held on to the wallet. Every once in a while, I get a little urge to send it back to him, but I kept delaying. I never did anything about it. Then Christmas rolls around. I'm stuck with nothing to do. Vinny was going to invite me over, but his mother got sick, and he and his wife had to go down to Miami at the last minute. So I'm sitting in my apartment that morning, feeling a little sorry for myself. And then I see Roger Goodwin's wallet lying on a shelf. I figure, what the hell, why not do something nice for once? And I put on my coat and I go out to return the wallet. The address is somewhere in Boreham Hill, somewhere in the projects. It was freezing out that day, I remember, and I kept getting lost trying to find the right building. Everything looks the same in that place. And you keep going over the same ground, thinking you're somewhere else. Anyway, I finally got to the building I was looking for, the apartment I was looking for, and I ring the bell. Nothing happens. I assume no one's there. I ring again just to make sure. And just when I'm about to give up, I wait a little longer, and I hear someone shuffling to the door. An old woman's voice asks, "Who's there?" And I say I'm looking for Roger Goodwin. Is that you, Roger? She says. And then she undoes about 15 locks and opens the door. She's got to be at least 80, maybe 90 years old. And the first thing I noticed about her is she's blind. I knew you'd come, Roger, she says. I knew you wouldn't forget your Granny Ethel on Christmas. And then she opens her arms as if she's about to hug me. I don't have much time to think, you understand. I had to say something real fast. And before I knew what was happening, I could hear the words coming out of my mouth. That's right, Granny Ethel, I said. I came back to see you on Christmas. Don't ask me why I said it. I don't have any idea. It just came out that way. Suddenly, this old lady's hugging me there in front of the door, and I'm hugging her back. It was as if we both decided to play this game without having to discuss the rules. I mean, she knew I wasn't her grandson. She was old and dotty, but she wasn't so far gone that she couldn't tell a complete stranger from her own flesh and blood. But it made her happy to pretend. And since I had nothing better to do, I was happy to go along with her. So, we both go into the apartment. We spend the day together. Every time she asked me how I was doing, I would lie to her. I told her I had found a good job in a cigar store. I told her I was about to get married. I told her 100 pretty stories, and she made like she believed every one of them. That's fine, Roger, she would say, nodding her head and smiling. I always knew things would turn out for you. After a while, I started getting hungry. Since there was no food in the house, I went out to a store in the neighborhood and I picked up a whole bunch of stuff. A pre-cooked chicken, vegetable soup, a bucket of potato salad, a whole bunch of stuff. Granny Ethel had a couple of bottles of wine stashed in the bedroom. And so both of us together managed to put together a fairly decent Christmas dinner. We both got a little tipsy from the wine, I remember. And after the meal was over, we went out to sit in the living room, where the chairs were more comfortable. I had to take a pee, so I excused myself, and I went to the bathroom down the hallway. And that's when things took another turn. It was ditzy enough doing my little jig as Granny Ethel's grandson, but what I did then was particularly crazy, and I've never forgiven myself since. I go into the bathroom, and stacked up against the wall next to the shower, I see a pile of 6 or 7 cameras. Brand new, 35mm cameras, still in their boxes. I've never taken a picture in my life, much less ever stolen anything. But once I see those cameras sitting there in the bathroom, I decide I want one of them for myself. Just like that. And without even thinking about it, I pick up one of the cameras, tuck it under my arm, and go out back to the living room. I wasn't gone more than 3 minutes. But in that time, Granny Ethel had fallen asleep. Too much Chianti, I suppose. I went out to the kitchen to wash the dishes. She slept through the whole racket, snoring away like a baby. There was no point in disturbing her, so I decided to leave. I couldn't even write her a letter to say goodbye, seeing that she was blind and all. So I just left. I put her grandson's wallet on a table, picked up the camera again, and walked out of the apartment. And that's the end of the story.
Did you ever see her again? Did you ever go back to see her?
Once, maybe 3 or 4 months later, I felt so bad about stealing the camera. I hadn't even used it yet. I finally made up my mind to return it, but Granny Ethel wasn't there anymore. Someone else had moved into the apartment, and he couldn't tell me where she was.
probably died.
Yeah. Probably.
Which means she spent her last Christmas with you.
I guess so. I hadn't thought about it that way.
It was a good deed, Auggie. It was a nice thing you did for her.
I lied to her and I stole from her. I was there. You could call that a good deed.
You made her happy. The camera was stolen anyway. Not as if the person you took it from really owned it.
Anything for art, eh, Paul?
I wouldn't say that, but at least you put the camera to good use.
And now you got your Christmas story, don't you?
Yes, I suppose I do. Bullshit is a real talent, Auggie. To make up a good story, you have to know how to push all the right buttons. I'd say you were up there among the masters.
What do you mean?
I mean, it's a good story.
Shit. If you can't share your secrets with your friends, then what kind of friend are you?
Exactly. Life just wouldn't be worth living, would it?